Okay, good evening, one and all. Today we move on to our next hashing algorithm, which is based on that is algorithm which is built from scratch. Like how MD4, today we'll be discussing about SHA, stands for secure hash algorithm. Okay, so this is also a derivant of MD4, but it is somewhat highly sophisticated and highly as well as the computationally complex, which make the hashing algorithm to be more robust compared to your MD4 algorithm. Okay, so SHA-512, as the name suggests, it is going to produce a message register of size 512 bit. Okay, and this SHA algorithm is also based on Merkley-Damrath scheme. I hope you remember what is this Merkley-Damrath scheme. So if you want to have a refresh, this is your Merkley-Damrath. So whenever I say a Merkley-Damrath scheme, means there will be a compression function coming into picture, where we are going to reduce incoming n bit of messages with respect to m bit of seed value to produce a m bit of hash value. Right. Same concept is going to be utilized in SHA. Okay. So if you see the general structure, so here the what you people have to remember in the sense, here the entire length of the message will be made into multiple blocks, each block of size 1024 bits. Okay, it's not like in MD4, okay, where we made a lesser than 1024 bits, and here the seed value is made up of 512 bits. So we can able to call this one as a registered word, or also called as your seed word. And this is your message word. Sorry, not a message word. It's a set of register words. We have set of register words. We also have set of message words altogether making 1024 bits. Okay. So this 1024 bit block will be given as input to the compression function, as well as we'll be providing a seed value of 512 bits. Altogether, which will produce me an output of 512 bit for after your first iteration, and which will be taken as an input for my second iteration. So this will be repeated until we complete the entire length of my message, and the final output will be taken as a message digest value. Okay. And one of the restriction in SHA-512 is, in the sense, the maximum length of original message can be maximum of 2 power 128 bits. So your original message should be less than or equal to 2 power 128 bits, and this whatever the message length which is going to be lesser than or equal to 2 power 128 bit will be given to a SHA-512 algorithm, which will give me a 512 bit digest output. Okay, and if you see preparation of the algorithm, the input message, it's typical same to our MD4. Okay, same way. So you'll be having an original message to which you're going to find the hashing value. Okay, so this obviously the original message should be length should be less than 2 power 128 bit. Okay, then I'll be using 128 fixed length bit. This is a fixed length bit. Always I'll be using 128 bit. If you remember in MD4, we'd have been using 64 bit to represent the length of original message. So in this SHA-512, we'll be using 128 bits to represent the length of the original message. So this is 128 bit, and this is the original message. After adding this part and this part, I'll check whether it is coming with the multiples of 1024 bits. If I'm not getting the multiple of 1024 bits, then only I'll be going with the paddy. So I'll be starting with the first bit as 1, and rest of the bits will be made as 0. Then if you add all this thing, then you should be able to have a multiple of 1024 bits, so that I can able to find multiple blocks each of 1024 bits. Right. So anyone have any doubt in this padding of messages? If it is clear, kindly raise your hand. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. This is the same concept which has been utilized in your MD4 algorithm also. So this is just whether you are understood or not, and it will test you. So suppose assume that you have your original message of 2590 bits, So can you tell me how many number of pairing bits is required? So this is your original message. To this original message, I will be adding a 128 bit for carrying the length of the message. Then only I will be going for a padding, right? So can you tell me what should be the length of the padding? So in this case, if you say that you have your 2590 plus 128 plus the padding length, assume it is sets, altogether if you take mod 1024, I should be getting the answer as 0. So can you people tell the answer for this one? Can you use chatbots or you can unmute and tell also, no issues. If you have understood the concept, you could have easily, otherwise, okay, if you want to make it mathematically simple, you have to find the answer for 25 minus 2590 minus 128 mod 1024 will give you the answer actually. I mean, you will be getting the answer in a negative way, and you have to convert them into a positive answer, and you have to tell it. Yes, Kunal, 354. Yes. So you'll be getting the bits to be 354 bits. So in this 354 bit, the first bit will be 1, and it will be followed with the 353 numbers of zeros. Right. Any people answer this? It's a yes or no question, whether you need a padding if the length of the original message, that is length of the original message, is already a multiple of 1024 bit. Yes or no? If yes, what is the reason? If no, what is the reason? Okay, Kunal, you are saying no, that is you have no need of padding bits. Again, I'm reading the question. Do we need a padding if length of the original message, that is length of the original message, is already multiple of 1024 bits? If you want to say pictorially, this length of the original message is alone a multiple of 1024 bits. Do I need padding or not? Yes, Ajay, can you tell the reason you need padding? Why? Answer is actually yes is the correct answer. Any proper reason why we need it? If you can unmute and tell, and okay, this is only length of the original message, because along with this original message, I'll be adding another 128 bit to convey the length of the message so that it won't be a 1024. Bits multiple, then I have to add with the padding, right? Now we move on to the next topic. What are these message words and digest words look like? If you compare with MD4, we'll be having a message block which is made of 512 bits, and this 512 bits will be divided into 16 words, each of 32 bit in MD4. But if you come for your SHF-512, your entire message block is made up of 1024 bits, and this 1024 bits are going to be divided into 16 message words. Okay, thereby each word making of 64 bit as a size. And this is your message digest, as well as I can able to say this is also your seed value or your register value. Both are also 8 words, each word made up of 64 bit, making 512 bits. So that is, you can able to see, this is also, this 512 bits will be made up of 8 words, and this 512 bits also made up of 8 words. That's why digest as well as your initial value, that is seed value, both are 8 words, each of 64 bit. And this, inside this 1024 block, I'll be having 16 words, each of 64 bit, right? this is how the message works and the register words are going to be placed.
Okay.
Next comes the most unique part of your SHFI tool called word expansion. Why I am going to expand the word? That is, if you take a message word, we saw that block have 1024 bits. Inside the 1024 bits, I am going to have 16 words, each made up of 64 bit. I have to expand the 16 words. So here the number starting from 0. So W0 to W15 is a first 16 word. I have to expand this word to get rest of the words such that altogether I'll be getting 80 words. That is, I'm expanding the available 16. Sorry, guys. Expanding the 16 words into 80 words.
Okay.
Such that I'll be using this 80 words for 80 rounds. So in SHFI tool, there are totally 80 rounds going to happen. And 18 rounds. Totally 80 rounds where each and every word, sorry, where each and every block will be undergoing. So each and every block will be undergoing this 80 rounds to produce a 512 bit output. So in order to supply a word, each word will be supplied with for each and every round, I am in need of 80 words to perform, to perform the 80 rounds. So for this, we are using a process called word expansion, where I'm going to produce the rest of the words from the available first 16 words. So how is going to produce in there? It's going to produce with respect to this methodology. So I just want you people to listen to the concept alone. Okay. So here, if you see the concept, if you want to go for any ith word, okay, this I will be always greater than this 15, okay, and less than ever 80. So this I will be taking a value from 16 to 79. Okay, so if we take this I value, so for example, first I will just go with the concept, then we will go with an example. So to produce this I value, I will be taking four words, that is I minus 16, then I minus 15, I minus 7, and I minus 2. These numbers 16, 15, 7, and 2 are fixed for irrespective what will be the value of my I maybe. Okay. Then I'm going to perform a rotational shift. Okay. That is based on these things. We'll come to this later. Okay. That is, this rotational shift of these three numbers 1, 8, and 7 is fixed, as well as this rotational shift of 19, 61, and 6 is also fixed. So this rotational shift will be done for this word WI minus 15, and this rotational shift will be done for the word WI minus 2. Okay. So this I minus 15 and I minus 2 will be going certain rotational shift. Then only I'll be getting outputs for all this, these two words. It should be XOR with my WI minus 7 and I minus 16, and I'll be producing my particular word. So what is this rotational shift, sir? So the general expression for rotational shift is shown here. Okay, that is, whenever there is a rotational shift of L, M, and N, what they will do in sense, first ROT R stands for right rotation. So you'll be converting all the values into bits. Okay, and the bit will be rotated in the right hand direction. So in a right rotation, L bits of rotation will be done for the particular input value of X. XOR with again right rotation with M bits for my the value X. Then shift left, SHL stands for shift left, and ROT R stands for right rotation. Actually both are going to be rotating thing, but this one is nothing but left hand side, this is nothing but your right hand side, that's all. This will be going for shift left with N number of bits for the input word X. So in this case, I'll directly go into example. So can anyone tell any value for I in between 16 to 79? Because up to 15, we'll be getting the value from the message itself. We have to find from 16 to 79. Can anyone tell any value for this I, so that I'll explain the example? Just concept, guys, nothing to do with your math here or any numerical. Just concept wise, you should be clear. You won't get numericals from these parts. So can you people, anyone say, or give a value for I? Okay, Kunal, you're going with 28, right? I think 518, so this is a new message. Okay, that is, you need your I to be 28. That is, I want to find word number 28 here. So to produce this word number 28, I am in need of four previously existing words. So I minus 16, wi minus 16, that is 28 minus 16. I'll be going with, what will be the answer? Can anyone tell? Guys, I want your interaction from you guys. Unmute enter. That is I minus 16. I'll be getting W. That is I is nothing but here 28, guys. So 28 minus 16, I'll be getting
12.
Yeah, yes, 12. Then the second word which is required is I minus 15, which is nothing but W 13. WI minus 7. So I'll be using W 21. And WI minus 2, I'll be using word number 26. So these words would have been already found. Actually, 213 is already available from the message words, whereas your 21 and 26 you would have been already derived. Okay. Now, your word number 13, which is nothing but my I minus 15, and word number 26, which is nothing but my I minus 2, will be undergoing this rotational shift. That is what I will do in the sense, I'll take word number 13. For example, I am taking the word number 13 and I am going to perform a rot shift of 1, 8 and 7 with respect to W 13. Means first I will perform rotational right shift of 1 bit of W 13. That is, I would have been converted this W 13 into an entire binary sequence. Then I will make a 1 bit right hand rotation. Okay. Then I will XOR with, again I will take my word W13 in terms of binary, and I would have made 8 bit round. So 187, this is 18 I am using here. Again I will XOR, then I go for my shift left with 7 bit of my W13. Okay, and I will XOR all these things to get this, assume that you are getting answers like it's here and this is why. Then same thing will be done with this WI minus 2 with respect to 1961 and 6. Then I'll be XORing all this four values to get the value of WA, that is W28. But anyone have any doubts in the flow, you can ask me. If it is clear, kindly raise your hand. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. Thank you, Vishal. So if I ask you for show how W60 is made, then you should show this expression. Okay. So we just saw why, we are going to expand this word and how we are going to expand the word. Next comes message digest initialization, or simply speaking, the seed value. The eight registered, message register words, which is the initial seed values, which will be supplied initially. That is, if you want to see this one, this is the initialization word, right? So these are the eight words which have been given by the people who have designed your SHFI tool, and they also gave the logic behind how, why they chose this one. So what they did in the sense, they took first 8 prime numbers and took a square root of the particular prime number. For example, if you take a square root of 2, I'll be getting 1.414. Okay. And they converted them into a binary. Binary only for the decimal point. After this decimal, they got some binary. And out of this, they took 64 bit on this binary and they converted them into hexa value. And this hexa value is nothing but A0. And for second prime number 3, they got the B naught. Like that, they repeated for 8 words up to the 19th value here. Okay, this is how they generated the initial seed value. Now we'll see what is going to happen inside the compression function. What does the flow looks like? Okay. So this is your seed value. So assume that this is your A naught, B naught, C naught, D naught, E, F, G and H. This is the initial seed value, which will be given for my first round. So generally they name the round as round 0. This round 0 will be supplied with your first word W0, and it has a round constant called this is a round constant. You'll see what are the round constants are. Round constant, and some operation will be happening inside this round. We'll see what is a round structure later. This is the compression function outer view, right? So this will be producing my output of my first round as A1, B1, C1, D1, E1, F1, G1, H1. It should be given for next. Like this, we'll be going for till 80 rounds. That is round number 79, where you'll be supplying with your last expanded word W79 and the round constant 79. So this is your final A79, B79, last this one, right? And this final output will be again XOR with my initial value here. You can able to see it is again XOR here. Then the final value will be taken as your message digest, or you can able to call it on as hash value. So this is how the compression function works. So I hope I am clear with the flow of a compression function. If anyone have any doubts, you can ask. If it is clear, kindly raise your hand. Because if you are clear with the compression function, then only you can able to grasp the round structure. That's right.
So can I explain once again, sir?
Okay. Yeah. So here, this compression function is nothing but the part which is going to happen inside this LO. This one is taking two inputs. Actually, here there is seed value and the seed value and the message, right? The seed value is this one, and this compression function altogether have 80 rounds. Totally 80 rounds, starting from 0 to 79, right? So each round is going to be supplied with the word. So we already saw that the message block is made up of 1024 bits, and this 1024 bits is split into 16 words, and we are going to use word expansion, as we saw here, this word expansion method to generate from the 16 words. We are going to generate totally 80 words here, right? So once we have this 80 words with you, I'm going to supply each round with one word and the round constant. I'll show this round constant in the upcoming slides. Okay, into the round. Now, inside each and every round, I'm having a seed value, I'm having one word and one round constant. And if you check all these things, everything will be made of 512 bit. Round constant is also 512 bit. Okay, and this word will be having, actually speaking, it will be a 64 bit word. But inside, the operation will be done in such a way that they will convert them using these three inputs. They'll convert, and they'll get output of next 8 register words. Okay, totally made up of 512 bits. Okay, this is also 512, this is also 512. Actually, this is 64 bit word, and this is also 64 bit. We'll see how the 64 bit and 512 bit is going to be operated in the next slide. Okay, so once this operation happens in round 0, that is your first round, I'll be getting output, and this will be repeated for 80 rounds, and the final output in the 80th round will be again XOR. This is a XOR operation with the initial seed value, and the final output will be produced and will be taken as a hash value. Hash value in sense, if it is for the first message block, okay, this is for your block one. Like this, this will be repeated. This 80 rounds will be keep on repeating until I complete the entire length of the message, and the final value after completing the entire length of the message will be taken as a hash value here. Otherwise, if you are going only for the first block, means the final hash value, which I said is nothing but this one, H1 is the first one, then it goes for second block, again 80 rounds. This inside this one, I am going to perform 80 rounds. Then second block, again 80 rounds. This is my H2. This will be repeated until I go in for the last block, again 80 rounds, and the final value will be taken as a hash value here. Final hash value. Am I clear? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Right. Now we move into the structure of each and every round. So inside each and every round, what is happening? Okay. This is also conceptual, just listen to this. Right. So each round is going to be supplied with the seed value. Assume this is for round 0. Round 0 means I'll be having A0, B0 up to H0, After everything, I'll be getting output as A1, B1, C1, D1, E1, F1, G1, H1. So actually, it is very simple for except two words. Rest of the words is very simple. That is, A0 will be pushed to B1, B0 will be pushed to C1, C will push to D1, E will be pushed to F, F will push to H, and G will be pushed to H here. That is, G0 will be pushed to H1 here. Right. So here we have to generate the values for A and we have to generate the values for E. Right. So in this operation, you can able to see the word D and H naught, or the D naught and H naught is not involved in the pushing of these words. So using this D and H naught, we are going to generate this A and E. So I'll just go for next slide, it will give a clear picture. Okay. So in this example, I'll be taking this A naught value, B naught value, C naught value here. Okay, then I'm going to perform majority function, which is a Boolean operation. So this is a majority function, Boolean operation here. Okay, A, B, and C. Then I'm taking the A part alone, that is A naught alone, and I'm going to make a rotate. So here, whenever I say rotate of A, rotational operation is nothing but right rotation of 28 bit. Again, XOR with right rotation of 34 bit. Again, XOR with right rotation of 39 bits. And these 28, 34 and 39 are fixed. It's not going to vary for each and every round or anything. It's always a fixed value here. Okay. So this rotation will be happening here. That is 28, 34 and 39. Okay. Yes, 39. Right. Actually, in book, they were mentioned as 29. Kindly change it. Okay. So it's 39. Fine. Now they have taken A, B, and C. They performed a Boolean operation. They performed a rotational operation for A alone. Then the output will be X. And this one you can able to see, these are 64, 64, 64. And this final output is 64. This again single word is also 64 bit. So I am getting output of mixer 1 as a 64 bit output. Okay. Now I am going for a next one, a next mixer. That is, I'm taking values of E, F, and G. That is, E naught, F naught, G naught. Here, I'm applying my Boolean expression as conditional operation here. And I'm again taking the E and I'm performing a rotational operation here. This will give me a 64 bit output. This will give me a 64 bit output. And here, I'm taking the H. If you remember, H, this already dropped here, is considered here. Okay. So this H is also a 64 bit value. And we already saw the word. Each round we will be supplying the word, which is 64 bit, and the round constant will also 64 bit. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. These 5 values are going to be XOR, and the mixer 2's output is also going to be 64 bit. Okay. Now, mixer 1 and mixer 2 alone going to be XOR, and I'm going to get a value called X, which will be kept for the new value of A1. Okay. And the output of mixer 2 is going to be XOR with D. This D, if you remember, they are not considered here, right? And they are considered here, right? And this D is XOR with the mixer 2 output, and the output final value Y is taken as a next values as E1. Now you have generated the values for A1 and E1. Only for generating A1 and E1, they are using more computational complex math. There are other values, they are just replacing the positions alone, right? Anyone have any doubts in this one, you can ask me. So all this plus symbols are nothing but your XOR operation. If it is clear, kindly raise your hands. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. So don't worry, examination, I won't ask you to perform these operations here. Okay. Mostly you'll be getting the Boolean expressions. Or this rotational part, and we'll discuss these examples in the upcoming classes. Now we move on to the round constant. This is the round constant for 80 rounds. 80 constants for 80 rounds. Yeah, here also they used the prime numbers, but with a little variation. What they did in sense, they took first 80 prime numbers. Okay, for example, the 80th prime number is 409. Here they're taking a cube root, not a square root, for round constant. Whereas if you go with your initial seed value generation, they went for square root. Whereas for round constant, they went for cube root. and this is the cube root of my 409. Okay, and they converted entire thing into binary, and they took only decimal part, this part alone, and they converted them into a hexadecimal. You can say 6C alone, this part, for the first 64 bit, and this value will be used as a round constant for my 80th round. You can able to see here, right? This is for 80th round constant. So anyone have any doubts so far? I'll just help you to do this Boolean expression, majority function and conditional function, without using any math. Just by seeing itself, you can able to do. Okay, there's a simple logic here. Majority function, I think you people can able to easily guess. So for this understanding, I'm just taking a very small size example. That is, I'm only taking only one hexadecimal digit. Okay, assume that we have a majority functions of buffers A, B, and C, like how we used to write as majority of A comma B comma C. Usually, we'll be supplying its 64. Each will be a 64-bit word. If it is from your SHFI 12, right? If it is going for your MD4, then the size will be varying, right? And it will be having 32 bits. So here, just for example, I hang 7, A, and E. So if you convert them into a binary value, so I'll be getting, this is nothing but my 7, this is nothing but my A, and this is nothing but my E. Now I have to perform the majority of A, B, and C. So what I'll do, since I'll first take the first bits alone, and I perform the majority function. So as the name denotes, among these three, what is the majority value here? Very simplest question. I've taken the first three bits as 0, 1, 1. What is the majority among this one?
1.
1. So the answer is 1. Next, I'm going for second bit, which is 1, 0, 0. Name to see 1, 0, and this is 1, right? 1, 0, 1, 1. Majority is 1. Like this, I'll be going for third and fourth bit, and like this, you have to go for 64 bits. So in examination, if you ask for 64 bit, easiest way, in the sense, just make a table. Okay, convert them A, B, and C, write them, and the answer, this is nothing but your output X or something, you can directly fill the answer. Just seeing which is majority, which is major, but the proper conversion and how properly you're writing them here matters, right? So in examination, you can use any ruled paper for solving at least this one. This will be easy for you to write the values, right? So you can able to get the answers easily. This is how a majority function works. Anyone have any doubt? And at last, you'll be getting this entire majority function. Then you have to convert them to hexa value here. Actually speaking, the majority function output will be any one of these input. Which is the majority value among these three input will be taken as output. So in this example, C is output here. Among these three entry, which is the majority one? Anyone have any doubts in this one? You can ask me. If it is clear, raise your hand so that I'll move on to the conditional property next. Okay, thank you, Rishabh. Thank you, Tushar. Okay. Now we move on to the conditional function. So here also I'm just taking three inputs like E, F, and G. And for easy understanding, I just took only one of the hexadecimal digit here. So if you convert them into binary, this is nothing but my 9, and this is nothing but my A, and this is nothing but my F. Right. So here, the first bits I'm taking 1, 1, 1. And here they say the result is F1. So when I say F1 means the first bit of my word F. Answer is 1. I'll give a clue. I want you people to tell me the answer. Okay. What is the logic behind this one? Now they have taken a second bits like 0, 0, and 1. So 0, 0, and 1. And the result is G2. That is the second bit is nothing. Second bit of the word G, which is nothing but this is okay. What is, oh sorry, this is F. This is word number E. This is word number F, and this is word number G. Right. So in this second bit of G is nothing but my 2. This is as G 2. So answer is this one. Now, the third bit they are taking, this is 0, 1 and 1. So 0, 1 and 1. And they said the result is G3. That is third bit of my G2. The answer is 1. Yes, last place 1, 0, 0. Result is F4. The fourth bit of my F word. This one. Answer is 0. Can anyone tell the logic? It's like your aptitude type question. How they are choosing F1, G2, G3 and F4. If anyone find, just unmute and tell. Very simple logic. I will give a clue. If I give a clue means the answer is directly with you. With respect to values of E, bit number, I mean bits present in first word E, they're deciding the output from F or G. That is based on the, I don't know, confused here. This is your bit number E, sorry, word number E, F and G. Based on the bit value of E, they are choosing whether F or G is output. Can anyone tell the answer? Yes. Anyone found the answer? At least raise your hand.
Sir, is it just XOR, sir?
No, it's a very, very simple logic. You could, oh, okay, you are okay. XOR also can go. Simply speaking, when your value of a bit from the first word is 1, you go for F. Whenever your value of my first word is 0, go for G. Whenever your value for your first word is high, go for my second word as output. So I mean second word's bit as output. Whenever my first word's bit value is 0, go for my third input bit value as output. So here I can able to see whenever E value takes 1, my outputs are F. Whenever there is 1, the output values are F. Whenever there is a 0, sorry. Whenever there is a 0 for the first word, my output values are G values. That is a third words bit. And again, if you convert this one, you're also getting the same value as I said is going to be here. It's from this example alone. Is it clear, guys? Conditional property. If it is clear, kindly raise your hand. This is easy way you can able to do the entire operation, because if you go with the Boolean expression, conditional operation, you can able to see this is the conditional function. You have to perform AND operation with these two words, then you have to take a complement of E, then you have to perform AND operation here, then you go for XOR. So easily the logic can able to use in the examination. Kindly raise your hands, guys, so that I'll be clear. So to conclude this one, we can able to see how the SHFI tool is computationally highly complex, thereby it's making it more resistant towards any attacks, even collision attacks. I hope you remember the third property, collision resistant property. So the collision attacks is also resistant when compared to your MD4. SHFI tool is highly robust. Okay, so with this, I am concluding today's session.